Honorable Justice Mahadevan, Mr. Gopalaswamy, Mr. Rajan, Mr. Cherian, Mr. Udaychandran, Mr. Ganeshan, above all, Mr. R. Balakrishnan. Actually, Mr. R. Balakrishnan and I have the same boss, and his name happens to be Sri Naveen Patnaik. Mr. Patnaik has sent me here personally to make sure that the Tamils do not hold him back, and I can take him back with me. Though I have said that in jest, but I must tell you that Bala sir, as he is very affectionately known in the entire state of Odisha, is the most claimed bureaucrat that the state has seen for a long, long time. It's not easy to be that. There are a lot of people who are very popular, but not necessarily effective. The IAS is notoriously famous for people who make it a parking lot for academic pursuit. You know, they come into the IAS confused about what they should be doing in life, and having crossed the UPSC, they write poetry, they write novels, they take two PhDs, they do this doctorate and that, and all that happens at the cost of public service. But, you know, once you are in, you are in. There are very few people like Bala sir here who spend a 24-hour day at office, move the needle, make the state visible and effective, and at the same time do what their heart tells them to do. You know, there are officers who are not corrupt, but not effective either. This is the worst kind of officer that you can find. You are useless. You're basically just riding a big blue whale. And then there are officers who are corrupt and effective. But there are very few officers who are extremely effective and completely incorruptible. And that's this man. In Odisha, people love him because of who he is, but also because Odias are very culturally deep and culturally sensitive people. But one man who is not born in Odisha but brought up in Odisha is Bala sir, who they think they defer to and who they think that he is an authority on Odia art, literature and culture, and he knows more about it than 99% of intellectuals in Odisha know about their own art, literature and culture. But he is also widely loved because he's non-partisan, he is humble, he's very accessible. It's very difficult to be accessible as a bureaucrat. And many people in the bureaucracy think that the best way to be effective is to keep your distance. Don't make eye contact. This man makes eye contact. In addition to all that, you know, in Odisha we are in love with him for another reason, and that is he is the champion of the indigenous people. He is the ultimate champion of the Adivasi population of Odisha, and we have the second largest Adivasi population in the entire country. But amidst all these things, there are two men who are responsible for getting me into my second life. That point is a very important point. Bala has a theory that you really flourish in your second life. Before your death, if people will get together to remember you one last time, it is not because of your first life, it is because of your second life. That's his theory. So who gave me this second life? There are two people. One happens to be the audience, and I'll not embarrass him by naming him, and the other is Sri R. Balakrishnan, who basically said, you know, if you can move the needle, come join the government. And that's that 1 rupee story that ma'am very affectionately narrated. So this is Bala's second life. Yes, he's been a great bureaucrat. He's been a writer. He's been a romantic, actually. He's both a mystic and a romantic. He's a die-hard romantic. And that's the reason that Sujata has been, you know, unstintingly supporting him. Okay. But in this book, actually, this is his climax. You know, this is his magnum opus. And I hope that this is not the last magnum opus. So in this second life thing, in this second life theory, this book that he has written, at a surface level and at a depth level both, there's a book on Indus Valley and the Tamil Sangam, of course. And by the way, I have read the book. So I think I'm entitled to make a few comments here. This is a profusely well-researched but eminently well-written book. And at some level, it's a book about the Indus Valley and the Tamil Sangam, which he very poetically says is separated by 1,400 kilometers and 1,300 years. Two different things in time and space, but the relationship is the same. A distance of 1,400 kilometers and a time hiatus of 1,300 years. It's a fabulously told story, fabulously told story. This book might be a book of somebody who is in love with history, love with archaeology, of course, anthropology, the sciences, the arts, the literature. But as I read the book, it felt like poetry. Anybody who loves poetry should read this book. It is how books should be written. And many times books are not read in our country because books make it so difficult for ordinary people. But this is no ordinarily told book. This book raises the narrative to poetry. And then it goes into philosophy. This book is not a book on archaeology and not just a book on history. It's a book on human philosophy, and I'll touch on that in a moment. But it's also a book on humanity. What does it mean to be human? Why a human being is a human being, and why it is important to ask that question as we stand in the middle of difficult times today. So it's a book written poetically, it's a book that touches philosophy, but it's a book that talks about being human. It's a book about humanity. This is a book on migration. And today India is burning because of migration. And this book talks about very interesting things. Why don't plants migrate the way human beings migrate? Plants migrate, but that's by seeding. The book quotes someone very eminent, says that a human being does not have roots. The human being has legs. That's why the human being moves from one place to another place. People migrate. And in olden times, the book talks about the fact that people used to travel only 16 miles in a year. That is how long it took to move. And imagine people moving from Mohenjo-daro and Harappa all the way to Madurai and to Tamil Nadu. How long did it take? What made those people to move? What were they thinking? What did they carry with them? What did they carry in terms of their pots and pans and their cattle? And what did they take as memories? This book is about memories. Memories of the past and memories of the future. I was delighted. I soaked in that book. It's one of the best books that I have ever read in my entire life. And this book is actually written like a poem, long poem, but it presents itself like a movie. The characters speak. They speak over different time and space, and they engage and they talk to you. Sometimes the author is speaking. Sometimes the characters of Mohenjo-daro or Harappa are speaking. Sometimes a Tamil poet begins to speak to you. Sometimes somebody from Mesopotamia appears and speaks to you. It is a stereophonic experience, a 360 degree and a stereophonic experience, which is extremely immersive. And what has made that immersive experience possible? And I'm going to give credit on this to not Bala sir, but to all the people who have put their heart and soul together to design this book. This is one of the most beautifully designed books in recent times. Every page of this book, I said, this should be a poster. We should frame this as a poster. I'd love to have all these posters in my study. It's so beautifully curated. Each picture is so beautifully selected. Each artwork is so beautifully presented. It's just an unbelievable experience. So I want to thank all those people, because this cannot be done by hiring the best person. Money doesn't buy this book. Money doesn't create a book like this. The infectious joy and the charm and the love for life that Bala sir stands for is presented in this book, and that has spread its tentacles to anybody who has come in contact with it in this particular project. You know, when you read a good book, it has to be taken, and I apologize for giving a metaphor that I'm going to give. It's like an exceedingly good limited edition French wine. You don't want to drink it in a hurry. You want to sip it very slowly, and you are all the time worried that it'll get over. I'm going through that experience right now. I have got this much left of the book, which I'm not going to read in a hurry. Thank you very much. This has been a delight. And you know, to all my Tamil friends, please know that he belongs to us more than belongs to you. But for now, please enjoy Sri R. Balakrishnan. And congratulations, Bala sir. Thank you.